Welcome to Thundercast, Thunder Tech's podcast where we give you our take on what's new in marketing, what's cool, what's lame, and why you should care.
Hey, and welcome back to Thundercast, Thunder Tech's regular podcast. As always, I'm your host, Craig Israel. I'm joined with my co-host, Eric Crilow.
I'm here.
Eric, we have a very special episode today. Just you and I.
I'm excited.
Just sitting around, breaking it down.
Yep.
So today we're going to talk about public service announcements, or PSAs, as we like to say in the biz.
Right.
So forgive me for a second. In case somebody, I guess, just woke up from a 20-year coma, that, you know, a PSA is a commercial often, but not just commercial. It can be radio, it can be print too, that's put out to promote some sort of usual social cause or improvement or something that's betterment for the country. Little background, a lot of these PSAs are put out by the Ad Council or the Advertising Council, which I'm sure you've seen it. Every time there's a PSA, you see, you know, something like a production of the Ad Council. Most people don't really care or know that it's a nonprofit organization that's been around forever. It was, looking at Wikipedia, it was founded in 1941 to help promote social causes, right? And undoubtedly, there was some aspect of let's show people that television and radio aren't just time wasters, that they're actually, you know, helpful for social causes too. Fun bit of trivia, in 1943 during World War II, the Ad Council was renamed the War Advertising Council.
Ooh, that means they mean business.
Right. So
you see, before we move forward, do you ever see any of our clients or the folks that we deal with going that direction in terms of a rebrand, whether they're, you know, the war tissue makers or, you know, war marketing? Wouldn't that be great if folks really started to adopt that sort of style of thinking?
Sure. I think, yeah, more violence and chaos in our industry would be fantastic.
Purge marketing, I think they'd call that.
So what? How this podcast came about is because Eric and I were talking about topics, and we had both seen some recent PSAs that were really striking. I know that one I saw, it's been out for a while, but it was the Sandy Hook PSA. You saw this one,
yeah,
Eric.
Yep.
Where, in case you haven't seen it, just go to YouTube and look up Sandy Hook PSA. Essentially, it tells the story of the message is that there might be a shooter, right, that somebody is planning a mass school shooting right before your eyes. And if you don't recognize the signs, that, you know, it's going to happen. It's a really interesting, engaging PSA that shows this cutesy relationship developing between this couple. But what you don't see is in the background of all the shots, there's this kind of this kid who's getting bullied, looking at gun sights, that's making, you know, threats to others. And it's not till the very end that the guy actually shows up in the gym with a rifle that they kind of flash back to all these scenes that are really apparent if you're just looking for it. And so much so that I had to go back and look at it again and be like, did they really show? Like, the guy's making, like, finger guns at the teacher. And I'm like, how the hell did I miss that?
It's exactly like The Sixth Sense. When you see right. It at the end and you're like, how the hell did I not know he was dead the whole time? Spoiler alert. But but yeah, and you know, the other interesting thing to me about that is, in looking back at some of these PSAs, how far the messages have grown in terms of what we're talking about.
Right.
So you go from something as simple as littering to a school shooting that was probably completely unheard of and not even thought of
sure.
back in the 70s.
Another PSA I saw recently was the Fans of Love. This is, you've probably seen this one too, where it's in a ballpark somewhere and they have one of those kiss cam things going around.
Yep.
And they're going through the audience, but they land on some really non-traditional couples. They have like an interracial couple and a same-sex couple. They have a couple where the woman's in a wheelchair. They have an elderly couple, and it's really cute, right? I'm usually not one for these sappy, tug at the heartstring sort of PSAs, but it had a good message and it was executed well. And I like to believe it was what you were seeing on the screen was genuine because the crowd cheers and claps. I hope it wasn't really, you know, they are booing and screaming out racial slurs.
I don't. Yeah, I'm glad that that didn't happen either. But the only thing that was a little unrealistic to me is, if you've ever been to an actual live sporting event, you know just as well as I do that the kiss cam never goes off as easy as that.
Right.
Not everybody's smooching. Some folks are just up to act a fool. So that's a little unrealistic to me, but I like the message, and I think it hits a good spot for folks.
Another PSA I saw recently, I don't know if you saw this, Eric, was the Deadpool breast cancer awareness, testicular cancer.
I didn't.
So not to be watched at work.
NSFW.
It's you know, Ryan Reynolds as Deadpool talking about these very important topics. But yeah, I started to watch it and found myself fast forwarding through it quickly before someone in IT responded to an alert and had me fired. But interesting and you know, kind of cool, and just shows that the PSAs, they can be relevant in today's market as much as, you know, Smokey the Bear.
Well, and, you know, for the most part, unless you're looking in the lower third of the screen, most of the time when these things kick off, you don't realize it's a PSA. And I think they've gotten a whole lot better at sort of masking that.
Right. Yeah, they're much more engaging. So speaking of that, as part of the show, we did some research into PSAs. And by research, I mean I Googled public service announcements to see what I got. And I came across a Washington Post article from a couple years ago where they ranked the 10 best PSAs of all time. So I thought we could spend some of our time here together, Eric, talking about the 10 best PSAs according to the Washington Post.
We are great at lists.
Yes, everybody loves lists. So I'm on board with most of them, and I think most of them are so iconic that people will immediately know what it is just from the name of it. But starting with number 10, going backwards, this one was from way back, World War II, from the War Advertising Council, as previously mentioned, and it is a slip of the lip will sink a ship.
Ooh. Stop snitching is exactly what that is.
Yeah, so I never realized that it wasn't loose lips sink ships. I assumed that's what it was. But, yeah, this was, pseudo-propaganda put out by the government to tell people to keep their mouths shut during the war.
Yeah, which is strange. And I think that that's a common theme amongst a lot of these top 10 is it's stuff that people kind of already knew, mm-hmm. but it's almost like you had to have someone to tell you that.
Yeah, I think the other thing is a lot of these are artifacts of their time, right? I mean, obviously this is a wartime thing. And in some of them, they seem less relevant or less impactful today than they did, you know, 20, 30 years ago. Yeah.
Now, do we have any record of any ships that were sunk due to loose lips? Or was this more of a cautionary tale?
I think it was a massively successful campaign where all lips remained unloosed and no ships were sunk. Part of the slip of the lip will sink a ship campaign, there was another message. It was, keep it under your Stetson.
Ooh.
Which I don't know how that didn't catch on and how that isn't as popular today as loose lips sink ships.
Well, and now is Stetson a type of hat or is it a company?
I think it's a type of hat, but I think it's also there's a Stetson hat company that makes Stetsons and other hats.
So this is like the whole Kleenex vibe
could be. And I don't know if there was something about maybe Stetson wares that was untrustworthy that they in particular needed to be reminded to keep their mouth shut.
And why does the general public have all of this secretive knowledge? Like, why aren't we keeping things, hush hush? Why do so many people know so many things?
It was a different time. Moving on, number 8. Number 8 was the toughest job you'll ever love, from the Peace Corps. So I'm an older man than you, Eric, and I remember these spots, but does that resonate with you at all?
It doesn't. I knew a couple girls in college that talked about the Peace Corps and ultimately went, but I'm pretty sure that all it equated to was like going to Ravenna twice and like helping someone clean up their trailer. I don't think it was anything like it used to be.
Yeah, so this PSA came out in 1961, about the time that the Peace Corps was created. President Kennedy created the Peace Corps. So I think this one is a good example of how approaching a problem differently can really make an impactful message in a way that a more traditional message couldn't, right? Because a Peace Corps was go overseas and help others. So the message could easily be, right, put in your time, make life better for other people. But instead, I think this really pretty engaging messaging, you know, toughest job you'll ever love, and it worked, right? The Peace Corps, the volunteers for the Peace Corps increased incredibly, and it was a successful program, and it's still, I think they still use that slogan today.
I can't be for 100% sure, but I believe I've heard that, so that would make sense, because I certainly wasn't around when those came out. Now, the interesting thing to me, as far as marketing goes for this one, is it feels like it's one of the first PSAs to have a real clear call to action.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas some of the other ones we're going to talk about today, it's more of a message than there is, okay, now that I know this, what can I do next?
Yeah.
So that stood out to me for this one for sure.
Yeah, and like any advertising or marketing, right, there's two parts of it, getting the message out and then telling people what to do with that message.
Right.
Number 7, you can learn a lot from a dummy, which maybe you don't recognize it from the title, but this is the crash test dummies, the seatbelt guys.
Mm-hmm.
No, Eric, oh. not those crash test dummies.
Oh, my fault.
I have all their albums. I'm legit a big crash test dummies fan.
All two of them?
All two of them.
Okay.
Yes, I have
all right.
Both. I have their whole catalog. I think it's in my car right now.
in cassette format. Now, Vince and Larry, were those the names of the dummies? Does anyone recall?
It is. I'm looking at it right now. Vince and Larry, the crash test dummies. This was another example of, using humor, right, to still put across a very important message. And I think this worked much better than if it was buckle up or, save a life.
Yeah.
Save your own life.
And with this one in particular, I remember this very well from being a small human. They would play this a lot during Saturday morning cartoons. And this is one of the few one of the few ads that really had a longevity. From what I understand, they ran these ads or versions of them from 85 to 1999. I mean, that's over 10 years of relevance. And for a lot of for a lot of these PSAs, I don't think that they set out to sort of create a character or to create a brand. But I think with the dummies here, they did a lot of that. They were selling toys. If I remember correctly, they had a partnership with Burger King, I believe, or maybe that was just because I ate a lot of fast food when I was younger. I can't remember. But definitely one of the first PSAs that I remember. And I remember it having an effect on me because essentially what they were telling me is, hey, buckle your seatbelt. Be real safe in the car. And I remember that striking me as odd because I was a small human and I didn't have a license. I'm like, why are they playing this to me? But it made a lot of sense because I remember getting in the car with my folks and reminding them to put their seatbelts on. And so that to me was a little bit unique.
So looking at this Washington Post article, it says that when the crash test dummies were introduced, U.S. safety belt usage increased from 14% to greater than 85%, saving an estimated 260,000 lives.
Wow.
So, I mean, the advertising marketing industry can be really cynical, but it's great to see something like this where some copywriter, art director sat down, came up with this idea, and then years later they can look back at it and see they made a meaningful, contribution to society.
Right. Well, I think the phrase you just used, meaningful contribution to society, I think in this particular case that is subjective because I think a lot of folks liked riding in the back seat of their parents' car back up in that window without a seatbelt, laying down, waving to folks.
So I'll tell you that as a kid, I certainly rode in the back of the station wagon, stretched out with my coloring book, just, napping. And, fortunately, I was never thrown through the windshield or killed. But, yeah, different time.
Thankful for that as well.
Number 7, and I think you know this one, Eric, only you
can prevent forest fires.
That's right. So U.S. Forest Service and National Association of State Foresters came out with this PSA, and of course that's the famous Smokey Bear. Most people get that wrong. It's not Smokey the Bear. It's Smokey Bear.
Which is interesting because I think for folks that can't see, I think it would be helpful if they let him know that it was a bear.
Yeah, Smokey Bear almost makes it sound like, like a ribs place.
Yes.
Or, you know, if the bear's on fire, which I think is counterproductive. But yeah, obviously, very popular campaign. According to this article, it's the longest lasting PSA in American history. And I mean, everybody knows Smokey and the Only You. And, you know, I remember seeing on ads and TV, and I've heard on the radio that it's everywhere.
And what I like about this one, especially from a marketing angle, is Smokey was not only latched onto as far as a character goes and used throughout history, but it made partnerships with other organizations really easy. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, the National Forest Association or, you know, the Parks Department, even the Boy Scouts, I believe, or Girl Scouts have had, you know, up and down discussions or interminglings, I guess, if that's the right word, with Smokey Bear. That's kind of sounded strange, but cut that one, Matt.
So... Number six, this is the first issue I take with this list from the Washington Post, because it's a Smokey Bear thing again. And then I haven't actually seen this one, but apparently they've recently upgraded the campaign. So now it's Only You Can Prevent Wildfires.
Right.
And instead of like Smokey scolding you for being careless, it says prevent wildfires, receive a bear hug.
Oh.
And I don't know if I'm really a fan. It seems a little special snowflake, let's not hurt Benny's feelings,
sure,
sort of approach. But then again, you know, I'm not going to argue with Smokey Bear.
Well, and you know, how many people are standing around at campsites, you know, doing the right thing with their arms outstretched and they're not getting hugged by a bear? Like, that's pretty messed up. So
you're right. Do you think this will lead to a rash of maulings where people try to approach bears for hugs?
You know, I'd like to say no. But based on 95% of what I see on social media, I believe it's happening as we speak.
Okay, top half of the list, number five.
So let's go back to that one for a second. And
okay.
Only because what we didn't talk about, and I want to share the other side of this, is we talked about a call to action previously. Mm-hmm. But I feel like with Smokey the Bear, he just tells you like, hey, bro, don't catch shit on fire.
All right.
But he doesn't really walk us through how. And so I think, at least in the early portions of those PSAs, they didn't really have that clear call to action. So I'm very curious as to why it caught on and why he had such longevity.
I want to go back and look at him, because I want to say that the original commercial showed, like, pour water on your campfire,
okay,
and kick it out. That they demonstrated things,
okay,
to do. Not because I want to say there was like a guy smoking when you could smoke on TV and just like flicked a cigarette into the, you know, the weeds, and then
pretty
Smokey Bear comes out of nowhere, and I mean, it'd be great if it just came out and mauled him,
right?
Only you, bro. But I don't think that's why I'm not writing.
Well, and I'm sure back then, instead of saying "Hey, don't smoke," it was "Hey, don't smoke there."
Right? It's like, well, everybody knows smoking is good for you, but just be careful where you throw your lit cigarettes.
Exactly.
Okay, number five, this is your brain. This is your brain on drugs. You know, I would argue probably one of the most famous PSAs ever, at least for my generation, right? I'm Generation X. I distinctly remember this, of course, is a cast iron frying pan with an egg saying, this is your brain. You crack it and it fries the egg. This is your brain on drugs. It really resonated and stuck with me as a kid. And it's probably, I gotta say, it's one of the most parodied, right, PSAs,
yep,
that we've ever seen too.
Yeah, and you know, that there's another great example of something that speaks directly to children. Mm-hmm. They had to make that as simple as possible, and the easiest way to do that is exactly what they did.
Yeah.
Take an egg, put it in a violent environment, and just watch it go nuts. Now,
yeah, because it was like 15 seconds long. It was super short.
Yep, and if you remember, it was just a very very almost overbearing father, or almost disappointed father, that's like talking to you directly when the commercial starts.
Yeah, because it right? Because it was like, this is your brain. This is your brain. Any questions?
Yeah.
And it was kind of...
Well, no. He starts it out with, you know, I can't, something along the lines of, and I'm paraphrasing, but it's like, you still don't know? You still don't know what happens?
No, it was like... okay, one more time.
Yes,
or
that's
like
yeah,
that.
Exactly.
Yeah, a little obnoxious,
yep,
right? But impactful, and I don't know if it really kept me or any of my classmates off drugs. I mean, maybe.
Yeah, I mean, all I thought about was when he asked if there's any questions. I'm like, yeah, when's breakfast? That's my question.
Yes. Just to be clear, Mom, I never did drugs in high school. That's not what I'm saying at all.
I don't even know what drugs are. I'm not sure if you've seen it, but there is one recently where they go through that exact PSA, and then when they say any questions, it flashes to kids now, and they're like, yes, are prescription drugs actual drugs? So actually expanding on that conversation.
I just saw that. I thought it was really strong. It was right the same setup, but then like it's a bunch of kids saying, yeah, prescription drugs is weed. Weed's legal, right? Is drinking worse than drugs? And the message there was your kids are going to have questions. Be prepared.
Yeah.
And I mean, as a father of a teenager, I mean, that really, really connected with me. Number four on the list, a mind is a terrible thing to waste. This is a spot by the now no longer politically correct named United Negro College Fund. And this came out in the 70s. And like I said, this is one of the ones that's clearly an artifact of its time, right? The UNCF, what they call themselves now, was trying to raise funds for more scholarships for minority students. And I remember this, right? Because I was you know, really young when this came out, but it was a really strong message. And I mean, there's no reason for it to connect to me, but I remember the spots and, you know, they were very successful at the time.
Sure. And, you know, this is one I it was probably the only one out of the list that I had never heard of or I'd never seen before.
Well, you've heard that phrase though, right?
I think I have. I just didn't know that that's where it came from.
Yeah. I think a lot of these that the headline, the message is so strong that it survives past its useful shelf life, right? That you may not connect it to this organization anymore, but it still floats around and people hear it, even though they don't know what it means.
I think the single most interesting stat that I read about this one was it generated $3.5 billion
towards the 70s.
Yes, towards scholarship accessibility. And I think that's fantastic. I mean, I didn't see any other numbers like that other than some of the percentages that you brought up for the crash test videos.
Yeah.
But I feel like this is one that definitely made an impact
based
purely on what was generated as a result of it.
Number three, take a bite out of crime. This, of course, is the McGruff, the crime dog. And, you know, when I found this one, I had to go back and, to your point, try to figure out what exactly were they telling us to do? Right, because I remember, like, you know, fight crime, right? McGruff telling us that, but I guess it was really about locking your doors.
Lock your doors. Don't talk to strangers.
Right.
Don't get into the van with strangers.
Good.
And the one commercial I remember specifically was a shot of the outside of a house, a moving van, movers. And it looked as if someone was moving. And then all of a sudden you see an animated dog, because those are things, and starts to talk. And essentially what he's saying is, these aren't movers, these are robbers. And they know that the Joneses aren't home, so they're just making it happen. Huh. In this day and age, I don't know if anyone goes to those lengths to rob someone. I think they just break in and sort of do the old get in and get out.
Well, I mean, I don't know. Is there a valuable secondhand black market for used couches?
I can't imagine. It was just very strange because it looked as if they were very well organized, and you don't see a lot of well organized criminals.
See, it amuses me to think that I could come home and be like, oh, I thought I locked the door, and you come home and literally the house is empty.
Right.
They've taken every piece of furniture, the family pictures off the walls. Right?
But what was that a thing? So like I totally understand that, you know, 30, 40 years ago, folks didn't lock, maybe 50 now, folks didn't lock their doors.
Right.
Which I guess makes sense, but did someone really have to tell them to?
Maybe.
And tell them not to let their kids get into cars with strangers?
Well, maybe not the latter part, but I mean, I grew up in small town Ohio, and we never locked our doors. Fortunately, no one ever thought to rent a U-Haul and just back it up and clean us out. What I think is interesting about McGruff is, to your point earlier about the crash test dummies, they introduced a mascot, right? They made a character. Which apparently they're still using to this day, and now McGruff talks about cyberbullying.
All right.
Yeah, so right on McGruff.
And he encourages it, or?
I think it's the other way.
Oh, gotcha.
He's against. All right. It's con.
Me too.
Okay. Number two, getting to the end here. Friends don't let friends drive drunk.
Incredible. Never have I seen more of a contradiction in any PSA that I ever have in my life. You're telling me not to do something dangerous by showing people with glasses in their hand slamming them together. Isn't that...
Were you like, that's a party I want to be at.
Right. Like, not only does it show, you know, folks having a great time, but like, isn't that almost as dangerous as driving drunk?
So, I guess. I mean, they never address the heartbreak of glass cuts in these commercials. But they did introduce the idea of the designated driver. So I kudos for that, because that was never a thing to my knowledge. So I mean, that's kind of genius, right? That there's some poor bastard who can't drink all night, and then he gets to drive all your drunken friends home.
Yep.
But I mean, you know, works. Down with that.
And, you know, and as far as that goes, like you said, introducing the designated driver, look at the effect that that's had on almost every alcohol ad we see today.
Right.
Drink responsibly. Yeah. Have a DD. I mean, it's certainly a message that has caught on and stuck.
Right.
And in some cases, I almost feel like it's mandatory now for any advertisers of alcohol to say that or to do that. And even if it doesn't dissuade people, and I think from what I read, 68% of Americans admitted to stopping someone from drinking and driving after this ad or as a result. Yeah. So if you think about that, that's you know, that's saving a bunch of lives, and it's good.
All right, number one on the list, and this is when you see it, when you hear it, it's obvious, right? This is the greatest PSA ever created. People start pollution. People can stop it, better known as crying Indian.
Correct. We can't say that word anymore. Native American works
better. Oh, I guess you're right. Sorry. But yeah, everybody has seen this spot. You know, this was, it debuted on Earth Day, 1971. And this is, you know, a bunch of punks throwing trash out their window. And then here's this very proud Native American, you know, standing by the roadside, single tear. It was... to this day, right? Tugs at the heartstrings a little bit.
And a couple things you may not recall and some issues that I have. First and foremost, were people just throwing trash everywhere back then? Like, was that, because from what I read, it was a real thing. It was a huge issue.
I think it was. I think this ad in particular went a long way. And it seems crazy today to think you have to tell people like, hey, don't just throw your crap out the window. Right? Or it's not okay to just throw a bag of trash in the ravine.
Right.
But I think, people were much more careless about it.
And this was blatant. I mean, as soon as that Native American hops out of his canoe, and speaking of canoe, he is awful at canoeing. They should have definitely given him a test run or used a stunt person, but this guy's awful at canoeing. But as soon as he steps out of that canoe, he probably takes four steps, and all of a sudden he's on a highway. And somebody rolls down the window and chucks a full bag of what appears to be slop and trash at this Native American's feet. Now, I certainly don't, no pun intended here, but that's a savage move. But it was no regard. It was just roll down the window, throw a bag of trash. So if that was happening back then, I'm more than happy to say that this is number one, and I'm glad that it had the effect that it did on folks.
It did. It's not to take anything away from this spot, but a little bit of trivia, the guy playing the Native American in this, Iron Eyes Cody.
Ooh, that's a great name.
It is a great name, and Iron Eyes Cody wasn't Native American.
Interesting.
I had to look him up on Wikipedia, and I think I knew this. I had heard this before, that he was a character actor that had played, you know, Native Americans in all the old Westerns. But, yeah, the guy was, like, Italian.
Oh, okay.
But, you know, good for him, right? He looked the part, and again, not to take anything away from the spot, but, you know, little fun trivia. So that's the list. A couple that I think are missing from the list. And we'll see what you think about this, Eric. I think the number one spot that's missing is, I learned it by watching you, Dad.
Oh, that's great.
dads who use, or parents who use drugs have children who use drugs. Oh,
and he walks in there and he shows his dad, or his dad shows him that jazz cigarette. And he's like, his dad just got this look on his face like, oh man.
Yeah. And he is like the perfect 70s dad. He's got the Mr. Cotter haircut. He's got the Mr. Cotter mustache. Mr. Cotter from Welcome Back, Carter?
No clue.
Well.
Anybody else in the room?
All right. Look, yes. Stop. Yes. I'm old. But yeah, I remember that spot, and I remember it actually, you know, connecting with me. Now, my father was an elementary school principal, so he certainly wasn't, to my knowledge, smoking pot like behind the school.
Sure. So you did not learn it from him.
I certainly did not learn it from him. But great spot, I think. Again, and maybe I'll take back the most parodied spot thing I said earlier, because I've seen plenty of parodies of that sort of message too.
Well, and who knows? Maybe the folks that were putting together this list thought to themselves, well, we can't have two drug PSAs.
Right.
So, I mean, they went with two Smokey Bears, but yeah.
Yeah. This is probably before your time, but I was disappointed to see there's no G.I. Joe PSAs. I don't know if you remember.
I remember at the end of it, it's like, you know, not the more you know, but it's more like, you know, G.I. Joe knowledge. Yeah. Don't get locked in a refrigerator when you're playing hide and seek in a junkyard.
Turn off the fire when you're making pork chop sandwiches. Right. Don't burn down the house. I love the G.I. Joe PSAs, and I was disappointed to see them. And going back a little further, talking about cartoons, this is definitely before your time, but Super Friends, when that was on Saturday morning cartoons, they had little PSAs too. Wow. And I had to go back and look, because I distinctly remembered, I learned how to do the Heimlich maneuver by watching Robin do it on Batman, because Batman's like, Robin, sometimes it's literally like a Thanksgiving table, and he's like, Robin, sometimes people choke when they're eating, and if they do, you need to do this. And he's like, and he does it, and he's like, do it again. It's important to get it right. It's kind of bizarre, but I totally learned Heimlich from Batman.
So just between us girls, and I think about this when I see this on the picture box, do you think that you could pull off a Heimlich successfully without breaking a rib?
I don't know. I mean, thankfully, I've never been in a position to try it, but I think so. I mean, the lessons that Batman taught me years ago have really stuck with me, and I think I could give it a go. But it's one of these things where, what if you're in a restaurant, a guy's choking, and you're like, here, hold on, I'll save the day, and you rush over there, and you do it a couple times, and you, like, do it wrong, and the guy's still choking?
Yeah.
What happens then?
I don't know, but I look at that situation just like I look at a situation when you're out at a group dinner and the check gets pushed down. I'm looking to see that it's happening, but I'm not the first to reach for it. You know, I'm going to see if anybody else is going to do it, and then I'll take my chance.
So we've talked a lot about PSAs in general, and I think let's loop this back to the whole purpose of this podcast, right? Because if you're a middle market marketing manager or business owner, you might be saying, why do I care about PSAs, right? I'm not a charity, or I'm not promoting a social cause. I'm just out here trying to sell my widgets. So what I take away from all these PSAs I've looked at recently is that it shows that you can really grab people's attention with impactful, unexpected messaging executions, right? Because a lot of these PSAs were TV commercials, but there was also print and radio, and you know, for example, the "This Is Your Brain on Drugs," right? This happened right at the end of the Reagan years, where they had been saying just say no for years, which wasn't very strong, you know, probably not very impactful. But then they come out with this, you know, egg frying thing, much more impactful. You could have said, hey, don't litter, right? Keep America Beautiful had been doing that for years. Like, hey, remember, don't litter. And then boom, you have this single tier that changes the game. So I think this is the message I take away from it, is that if you have an important message, and it might be just buy my stuff, if you approach it in a non-traditional, impactful way, you're going to grab a lot more attention and get way better results.
Yeah, and if something is successful, don't be afraid to play off of that, you know, and you know, create other things, supplementary or complementary content thereafter to support that, move it forward. Because like we talked about with Crash Test Dummies and Smokey Bear, they can have a lot of legs and be used for quite a bit of time.
Yeah. All right, I think that's it for Thundercast this week. If you liked what you heard today, you can subscribe to Thundercast on iTunes, Stitcher, and wherever fine podcasts are sold. If you do subscribe on iTunes, why not take a second and leave a review? It'd really help us out. Thanks. If you're dying to hear more, our full library of past episodes can be found on our website at thundertech.com/podcast. Thundercast is a production of ThunderTech, an integrated agency for the connected world, proudly headquartered in Cleveland, Ohio, serving clients in Detroit, Chicago, New York, around the nation, and internationally. Your host is Craig Israel, joined by co-host Eric Crilow. This episode was recorded, edited, and produced by Matt Stevens. Thundercast production coordinators are Hannah Steinker and Shantae Rollins. Special thanks to Tom Hanks. He knows why. Now, Eric, if you had to pick one cause to create a PSA for, what would it be?
Don't touch the glass at fast casual restaurants when you're ordering. It's gross and I'm tired of it. Every time I go to Chipotle and they ask you what you want, you just say the words, man. You don't have to touch the glass and put your gross hands on there. So just don't do it.
Words to live by. All right.
Touch the glass, I beat that ass. Does that work?
That's good message. All right. Thanks for listening.